Hey, boys and girls, it's Miss Cindy. I thought I would try something new. This week, every week, I've tried different things, and we are all learning how to navigate through all of this online learning. So this week, I'm going to try videoing myself, which is not my favorite thing to do, but I'm gonna do it anyway. And I'm gonna go through the lesson with you today, and nothing fancy because this is really not my thing. But like I said, I'm learning. But I'm gonna go ahead and do our lesson this way and see how it goes. So I have the lesson in front of me, so occasionally you're gonna see me reading off of my screen, and I have some really fun things that I want you to go and do. So just, have some, you're gonna need a paper clip, so you're gonna need to have that handy. So if you need to pause this and go get a paper clip, go get it. But I'm gonna go ahead and start our lesson. So today we're learning about God's commandments, and you might think that sounds like a bunch of rules, but God's commandments are like street signs showing us the best way to go. So today we're going to learn that we respect God's name when we talk. So like I said, you're going to go need a paper clip. So if you haven't grabbed one yet, go get it. And if you don't have a paper clip, you can use a bobby pin. You just really need something that's like the size of a paper clip, something small. All right, so we're learning about God's commandments. This week's commandment is about God's name. So I'm going to go ahead and read Exodus 27 with you. So that would be Exodus chapter 20, verse 7. And if you want to have your Bible handy, you can do that and read it along with me. But I'm going to also go ahead and read that for you now. All right, so you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. So what do you think it means to misuse God's name? So if you want to go ahead and talk about that with somebody at home, but what do you think it means to misuse God's name? God's name has power, so we respect God's name when we talk. When we use his name, we're saying who he is. When we misuse his name, like saying it as a curse word or a statement of surprise, we're not representing God well. So imagine your name is Sadie, and I do have a little Sadie in Sunday school. So I'm wondering if she's watching right now, and if she is, hi, Sadie. But imagine your name is Sadie, and you trip and fall in front of everyone at school. Now, whenever anyone trips, they call it pulling a Sadie. So how would you feel about that? Probably not very good. So it matters to us how people use our names, and it matters to God how we use his name. But in order to understand who God is and why his name is so special, we need to know what his name is. The Bible uses a lot of different names for God, so we're going to go ahead and look at those. So if you want to look it up in the Bible, the next few verses I'm going to read is Exodus chapter 3, verses 13 through 14. So again, if you need to pause me to find that, go ahead and do that now. All right, so here's what Exodus 3, 13 through 14 says. Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is your name?' Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. That is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you." I am may seem like a really weird name. So, what do you think I am means? So, if you need to, go ahead and tell somebody that you're with what you think I am means. And it may not be a name we're used to, but I am is the ultimate way for God to say he just exists. He doesn't depend on anyone or anything to exist. He just does. So, let's explore what that means. So, here's where you're going to need that paper clip. Okay, so your goal is to have a paper clip be exactly at the shoulder height of the youngest person in your home, but you can't hold it. So you need to go find the youngest person in your home, and you need to make your paper clip be as high as that youngest person's shoulder. but you can't hold it there. Okay? So, how are you going to do that? So if we were at church, can you imagine how much fun this would be? But I want you to try this at home. So think about it. You have a paperclip. You have to make it the shoulder height of the youngest person in your home. How are you going to make it that high without holding it? Okay, so maybe you need to stack things to hold up your paperclip. So look around. What can you do to keep your paperclip as high as the youngest person in your home? So I'm wondering what you guys would have done at church. So knowing you guys, you would have done something very interesting. But anyway, I really wish I could see what you were doing. And honestly, boys and girls, I know I've put this out a couple times and I've heard from some of you, but I would really love it if you took a picture and put it like in the Facebook group. Like, your parents can do that, or they can email it to me. I've gotten a couple texts, and I've seen some of you on Flipgrid. But I would love it if you would take a picture of how you made your paperclip as high as the youngest person in your home and send it to me. That would really, really, really make me smile. So please, please, please have a picture of it and get it to me somehow. Ask your parents. They know how to get it to me. All right, so I would love it if you guys did that. All right, so go ahead, and I want you to pause this, and I want you to go through and figure out how you're going to make your paperclip go up to someone's shoulder, your youngest person in the home, okay? All right, so welcome back. And what does your paperclip depend on in order to be where it is? So I really, really hope you took a picture of it. Make sure you send it to me, because I really miss you guys, and this would really make me laugh. And you guys know I love to laugh and would love to see how you pulled this off. So what do you depend on in order to exist? So I would say you depend on food, water, air, or heat. Were you thinking the same thing? I bet you probably were. Okay, so God is called I Am because he doesn't depend on anything. He just is. That's an amazing example of his power. Because God is I Am, we respect God's name when we talk. Before we look at the next name of God, let's play a game of Would You Rather. So you can play this with someone at home, and if you need to pause in between, so you can talk about it, you can go ahead and pause it. Pause me when you need to. Okay? So here we go. So, would you rather break your leg or win $1 million? That's an easy one, right? I'd rather win $1 million. Would you rather have your house burned down or win $1 million? Would you rather trip and skin your knee or win $1 million? Here's the last one. Would you rather play a board game or win $1 million? So obviously, one choice was better every time. So in this game, even choices like eating a brownie or playing a board game weren't even close as good as winning the $1 million. It would be way more fun to win $1 million and then spend it on whatever we want. So this game kind of showed us how God compares to anything else. Compared to everyone else who's important, God is way above them. All right, next I'm going to read Deuteronomy 10:17. And again, if you want to follow along in your Bible, you can pause this and find it. But I'm going to go ahead and read it here. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. God is the God of gods and the Lord of lords. Compared to him, everything else obviously falls short. Because God is better than anyone or anything, we respect God's name when we talk. And our next Bible verse is going to list four names for God. So listen for the one that means most to you and be ready to tell why. So now I'm going to go ahead and read Isaiah 9. So that would be chapter 9, verse 6. For us a child is born, and to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So which name means the most to you and why? And again, if you need to pause this and talk to someone who is with you right now, you can do that now. So let's take a look a closer look at two of them. One is mighty God. Let's think about what it means to be mighty. So I'm not going to actually do this, even though you probably want me to. But how many push-ups do I want you to do? As many push-ups as you can until you feel like you can't do anymore. Okay, so go ahead and pause and go ahead and do as many push-ups as you possibly can. I'm not going to do it. And honestly, if Bill was down here, I'd have him do it, but he's not. I'm by myself. So I'm not going to do it. But you go ahead and pause this. Do as many as you can. All right. So how many push-ups could you do? So tell someone at home how many you did. And you could, since we're all kind of, I know I'm not exercising as much as I would like to, but you could go ahead and maybe challenge your parents. And I know they're all not going to like me for this, but maybe challenge your parents to see if they could do more push-ups than you. And that would be something that you could videotape and send me. I would love to see your parents do this too. So how did you know when you were finished? Well, I'm guessing that I knew I was finished when I couldn't do anymore. But I'm not going to do them. I already worked out today, so I'm not going to do it. Even the strongest human will run out of strength to do push-ups eventually, but God never runs out of strength. He is strong and mighty. Because he is our mighty God, we respect God's name when we talk. God is also our Prince of Peace. God brings all of that. Let's enjoy a moment of peace. Sit in silence and just receive peace from God. So I'm going to go ahead and going to pull up some calming music on my phone, and I'm going to set the timer for 1 minute. So what I want you guys to do is find a cozy spot, and I'm going to show you my phone's timer, and we're just going to sit here and listen to some quiet music for 1 minute. Okay, so you can close your eyes if you want to. You can just sit and watch the timer if you want to. Of course, I can't find. Oh, here it is. All right, so 1 minute, we're going to sit and be quiet. All right, so let me stop this. So I'm wondering how many of you were able to sit for 1 minute. I usually like to meditate for at least 10 minutes a day, so I haven't been able to do that as much since we've been shut down like this. But it is really good for your brain, and one of these days I'll tell you more about that. But I'm wondering how many of you sat for 1 minute. In fact, why don't you come on up here and give me a high five? Good job. I know it's not easy. It isn't. But we need that. So, all right. Now I'm going to read Revelation 1:8. So again, if you want to follow along, find Revelation 1:8. And it says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. So this verse says God is the beginning and the end, but it also says he is, always was, and still to come. So how can that be true? So the name Alpha and Omega might not make sense to you because it's another language. And Alpha and Omega are the first and the last letters of the Greek alphabet. So it's the same as saying God is the A and the Z. That's why it means the beginning and the end. But unlike the alphabet, God doesn't really have a beginning or an end. God is the Alpha and Omega, meaning he always was, which means he was there when our world began. He will always be, which means he'll be here when our worlds end, and he is forever. And that's why we respect God's name when we talk. All right, so let's look at one more word used to describe God. All right, so we're going to read, and the word is holy, by the way, and we're going to read Psalm 22, so Psalm chapter 22, verse 3. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. All right, so God is holy. That's not a word we use a lot. So let's figure out what it means. So I want you to use this phrase, and oh my gosh, I so wish I could see you guys right now because this would have been a great conversation to have. But I want you to finish this phrase. The phrase is, I wouldn't use my toothbrush anymore if it had touched blank. So turn to someone at home and say, I wouldn't use my toothbrush anymore if it had touched, and what is it? Okay, so for me, I would say, I wouldn't use my toothbrush anymore if it had touched the toilet seat. Or I would say, I wouldn't use my toothbrush anymore if it touched the coronavirus. So what about you? What would you say? And again, if you say something, parents, if you're watching this with the kids, feel free to text me, Facebook me, whatever, because I really miss our conversations on Sunday. Your kids are really great at having conversations about these things. So why wouldn't you use your toothbrush if it had touched those things? Well, obviously, I don't want to get the coronavirus, and I don't want anything that has been near the toilet to come into my mouth. So that's what I'd say. And I can only imagine what you're saying right now to your parents. All right. Another way to describe holy is set apart. If something is really special and you don't want it to get polluted by bad things. So if something's special, you want to keep it that way. You don't want it to get, you know, messed up, just like you want to keep your toothbrush clean and pure. And God is clean and pure, and he's set apart from the bad, evil things in the world. So God is holy, so we respect God's name when we talk. Now that we know more about God's names, we understand why he's worthy of respect. So what does it mean to respect his name? It's about our hearts. So I want you to repeat this sentence after me, but in your saddest tone of voice possible, okay? So the sentence is this, and I'm going to try to say it in my saddest voice possible. I'm so excited to go to the amusement park. So can you say that to someone, but with your saddest voice? Maybe you could even get dramatic and start crying. I'm so excited to go to the amusement park. So how well did your tone match the words you were saying? Isn't that weird for me to say that in a sad voice? So what are some examples of how people might say God's name in a way that doesn't reflect a heart that loves him? When we respect God's name, our words match what our hearts believe about him. And we believe God is holy forever and the Lord of Lords. So our words reflect that. So the lesson that we should have learned today is that we respect God's name. Okay, we don't say God's name in a way that doesn't show respect. We want, when we're talking about God, we want to be respectful. So I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to be in an attitude of prayer right now. I'm going to go ahead and pray for us. So thank you, God, that your name is special. Thank you for watching over us and taking care of us. And please, Lord, help us to find peace in this time. Thank you for every single kid and parent that's watching this right now. And I pray that we could all go out in the world together and praise your name. Amen. All right. Well, let me know what you guys think of this video. I know it isn't anything super fantastic like we would have done it at church. But I really miss you guys. So I hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.